Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Silver Lake Kendall Methodist Church. My name is Cameron Miller. I'm the pastor here, and it is such a great joy to be worshiping with you all together here today on this beautiful November morning. As we begin our time together this morning, I want to lift up a few announcements and then open up to any announcements you all may have. The first one today is poinsettia sales are due today. So on your way out, if you're still wanting to buy a poinsettia, there is a sign up, or there's a little form on the little desk right out in front of the door here where we have, where you get the bulletins. There's a form there where you can fill those out, and they are $10 a piece. So I'll be putting in that order this afternoon. So now is your last chance to get those. And then the office is going to be closed tomorrow and Tuesday, as I'll be at a retreat. This will actually be my final retreat like this that I've gone on several times over the last year and a half. But so the office will be closed. If you need me, email is going to be the best way to reach me. Cell service is a little spotty, and so I'll have a little bit better internet, at least most of the time. And the next week is a couple of things. Next week is our Stewardship Sunday, so I invite you to bring your filled out pledge cards next week. And then also we have the honor of having the Reverend Dr. Dustin Petz come and preach for us. He is one of the pastors in the United Methodist Church, and he is the CEO and president of the Kansas Methodist Foundation. And so we'll get to spend some time with him next week and listening to his sermon on generously giving, both in our lives now, but also he's going to really focus on what it looks like after we pass away, on how we can be faithful givers then as well. And he'll be offering a class after church next week as well, from 11:30 to 12:30. So I want to invite everyone to come and take part of that. It's a really great resource that we have. He has a true passion for money and how finances relate to our spiritual faith, and he always gives great presentations. So I really would invite all of you to come and join us next week after church for that wonderful message that he's going to share with us. Those are the announcements that I have this morning. And so do we have others? Let's go to Kathy first, and then as we're walking over, we can get Jane after.
Good morning. Two wrap-up things from Harvest Home. We're going to be wrapping up the bazaar today, so after church is your last chance to buy any of those items, and then they'll be taken down and taken home today. And then also, after snack time, we'll have a quick Harvest Home wrap-up meeting. So if anybody wants to come and share any feedback, ideas, things we should think of for next year, please join us, and we promise to keep it short and sweet. Thank you.
Thank you. Jane.
Good morning. It's the last time you're going to hear about the scholarship fund for this year. Today is our last official day of where we're going to talk about it. And I want to give you a reminder. We're entering the season of gift giving. And it's often a time that is filled with stress, and you wonder, will anybody like anything I'm giving? Will anybody care? But think of a gift to the scholarship fund as building a strong foundation and future for our youth as they proceed on to whatever they may choose to do in advanced education, whether it's a community college, a vo-tech school, or a college or university. This is our chance to build a solid gift-giving future for them with your gift. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. Yes. Consider today how you might be able to give to support our scholarship fund to help support our students who graduate from this church and are moving on into the next steps of their lives, or we can still continue to show them our support. You can give today through our offering time. There are some envelopes, there should be some in your pews that you can fill out, and just make sure you write on there that it's for the scholarship fund, or you can do so online, making sure that the same thing, that you just put in the memo line that it's for the scholarship fund. Do we have any other announcements this morning? If there are no other announcements, then we have a few birthdays to lift up this week. Today is Lou Snyder's birthday, so happy birthday to Lou. And then we also, Cannon Jackson's birthday is the 14th. Jean Brewster's birthday is the 18th. And so is Laureen's birthday is the 18th, Laureen Goodman. So happy birthday to all of our birthdays this week. And we are just so blessed to have you all here. So I would invite you now, are there any other birthdays or anniversaries in the coming week? If not, then I invite you to rise in body or spirit and join me in our call to worship. Today, God's word has spoken to your hearts. Open our ears and our hearts to receive God's word. Today, God's love will be poured into your life. Prepare us, Lord, to receive your love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I invite you to remain standing as you are able and join in our opening hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King, number 62 in the hymnal.
You may be seated. Please join me in the unison prayer. Merciful God, we confess that we neglect to acknowledge you as God in our lives. We live like we have complete control over our own future. We forget that you created us and that we are the sheep of your pasture. We separate ourselves from the flock and abandon our bonds with one another as we try to do it all on our own. We have traded gratitude for individualism and thanksgiving for self-reliance. Forgive us, we pray. Free us to live as your grateful people. Amen.
That brings us to our time of sharing of joys and concerns this morning. And as we begin, I just want to take a moment to recognize the veterans who are in our community today. Yesterday was Veterans Day, and so today we have an opportunity to lift up a special prayer for all of our veterans. So if you have served in any form throughout your lifetime, I'd invite you now to rise or raise a hand so that we can recognize you today. We thank you all for your service to this country and for the sacrifices that you all have made, and we just say a special prayer for you today. Do we have other joys or concerns to lift up this morning? If not, then I would invite you to join me in a time of prayer as we do say a special prayer for those who have and are serving. Holy God, who promised to never leave your children's side, we give thanks to you for the soldiers who have made it home safely, and we are grateful for you for those you have ushered into heaven straight from the battlefields. Bless our soldiers and hold them safely in the palm of your hand. Bless our soldiers' families and friends. Help them to always be a source of joy and strength for our military. We ask for healing, Lord, of wounds we can and we cannot see, of memories that may never be resolved, and of the spiritual relationship with you that sometimes feels so broken. Let your grace pour down upon those who have served in the battlefield, who often return to a continuous battle of transition to civilian life. Lift up those who are feeling lost, those who are feeling unappreciated, and those who cannot accept the magnitude of their sacrifice. Guide us as your church to minister to your sons and daughters of war, not just on these special occasions, but every day, seeking new ways to support them in gratitude for their ultimate sacrifice. May we become soldiers of relief for them, responding with patience and understanding and providing assistance where it is needed. Help us to become good listeners, a safe haven for our soldiers to speak of their experiences regardless of the horror they may have seen. For in speaking begins healing. Refresh us, Lord. Fill us with your Holy Spirit so that your love may overflow in all of us, bringing peace and joy and wholeness to us and to those who have served and to those who continue to serve our blessed nation. We thank you for their sacrifice, and we thank you for the ultimate sacrifice in your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to remain seated and join in our next hymn, O God of Every Nation, number 435 in the hymnal. Thank you.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of 1 Timothy in the 6th chapter, verses 6 through 12 and 17 through 19. Please rise in body or spirit for the reading of the scripture. A devout life does bring wealth, but it's the rich simplicity of being yourself before God. Since we entered the world penniless and will leave it penniless, if we have bread on the table and shoes on our feet, that's enough. But if it's only money these leaders are after, they'll self-destruct in no time. Lust for money brings trouble and nothing but trouble. Going down that path, some lose their footing in the faith completely and live to regret it bitterly ever after. But you, Timothy, man of God, run for your life from all of this. Pursue a righteous life, a life of wonder, faith, love, steadiness, courtesy. Run hard and fast in the faith. Seize the eternal life, the life you were called to, the life you so fervently embraced in the presence of so many witnesses. Tell those rich in this world's wealth to quit being so full of themselves and so obsessed with money, which is here today and gone tomorrow. Tell them to go after God, who piles on all the riches we could ever manage, to do good, to be rich in helping others, to be extravagantly generous. If they do that, they'll build a treasury that will last, gaining life that is truly life. May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of God's word. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I want to invite any of our children that may want to head off to Sunday school to do that at this time. Today we conclude our sermon series, Earn, Save, Give. We've got this from John Wesley's sermon, The Use of Money, where he said, if those who gain all they can and save all they can will likewise give all they can, then the more they gain, then the more they will grow in grace and the more treasure that they will lay up in heaven. The first week of this series, we explored what it means to earn all that we can, to try and acquire as much earnings as we can through our jobs, but to do so without taking advantage of others and especially without taking advantage of ourselves. Then last week, we talked about what it means to save all you can. This includes how we are spending our money and making sure that it's done on the right type of things, how we are saving for our future, like retirement or college accounts for our children's, the importance of understanding personal finance to prevent money from becoming a burden on us whenever possible. Today, we finish out Wesley's three rules by exploring what it means to give all that we can. How to give as people of God is something that we have trying to figure out as God's people forever. Our scripture talks a lot about how we are to think about and relate to money, and it gives us something to consider as we think about how we are to relate to the resources, our resources to God's mission. One of the first times we hear about this is in Genesis 28, as Jacob, Abraham's grandson, is encountering God in a space. Jacob made a vow saying, if God will be with me and will keep me in this way, if God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and clothing to wear, so what, I come again to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God, and this stone which I have set up for a pillar shall be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will surely give one-tenth to you. This is the first time we are introduced into this practice that we know as tithing, or giving the first 10% of our income to God's mission. Jacob had a dream. This is the dream where Jacob saw a ladder leading to heaven of the angels coming back and forth in this connection between us and God. And when he was here, God gave him the promise that this land that he was laying in would be the promised land given to God's people.
And Jacob's response to this was to create a space to build an altar out of the stones that he had laid his head on and to offer 10% of everything that he had of his earnings back to God. The idea that a tithe should be part of everyone's faith journey comes to us in Leviticus 27:30, where it is stated, "All tithes from this land, whether the seed from the ground or of the fruit of the tree, are the Lord's. They are holy to the Lord." This commandment was given to Moses as he received many of his commandments on Mount Sinai in the wilderness in the 40 years after leaving slavery in Egypt. These scriptures are kind of the foundation of tithe, of the spiritual practice of tithing. The thing with tithing is that it's really not about us giving money to a church or to this church specifically for us. But what it's about is it is about a way for us to think differently about our finances, about our resources, and the physical act of what we're doing to relate that to the spiritual part of our faith. Tithing is a way for us to grow closer with our Creator, to give back to God just a fraction of what God has given to us. To do so is to be in relationship with God so that we can live out a different life from those around us and first and foremost give thanks to God for what we have received. Throughout much of Jewish and Christian history, tithing is what has seemed to be that we were called to and was our financial ultimate goal as Christians. But John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, challenged that tithing was the goal in our lives and said, "Tithing is something that we strive for, but it's certainly not an end in our giving journey in our faith." Instead, Wesley challenges us to live into the heart of what tithing really is, participating in God's mission through not just our faith or putting our hands and feet into action, but through our finances. For Wesley, it wasn't really about tithing, but it was about giving all that we can. Our scripture that we heard today from 1 Timothy speaks as listens to how Paul is speaking about money. Paul is writing to Timothy, a friend and follower of Christ, about many things in this letter, but here at the very end, one of the last things Paul shares with Timothy is how to relate his life to the money that he has received and will receive. Paul tells us, devout Christians, that life does bring about wealth, but it's the rich simplicity of being yourself before God. Since we entered into the world penniless and we will leave the world penniless, if we have bread on our table and shoes on our feet, that is enough. This is Paul's idea of what it means to be rich. It's not about having a bank account that continues to rack up zeros on the end of it. It's about having a relationship with Jesus Christ that brings us into the world to bring about love to God and neighbor. Now, Paul says that having just bread on our table and shoes on our feet is enough. Now, I think we can really look at this a little bit deeper, and there are some other things that we might need as well. Some things that can help us, whether that be a roof over our heads or whether that be a phone to communicate with our loved ones and our family and friends. It can be a car to make sure that we get place to place or a way to find someone who we know is willing to help us. There are these things, and Paul is really asking the question of what does it mean to be rich? We get this narrative in our society that if I just make more, then I will be happy and all of my problems will go away. But really, truly, we know that this is not going to happen. Because we know that it isn't true that money buys happiness, and that is exactly what Paul is telling us, is that it's not money that brings happiness, but happiness, purpose, richness in life comes from a relationship with Jesus Christ. He is asking us the question, what do we really need? What do I not need that I am wasting time, energy, and resources on? And Paul gives us these examples here of the things that we do need, of food and shoes. But there are other things that we truly need besides these. Paul then tells Timothy to live a righteous life of wonder, faith, love, steadiness, courtesy, and to seize eternal life. But then Paul gives a warning, and he gives this warning to Timothy to share with those in the world. And Paul says this: tell those rich in the world's wealth to quit being so full of themselves and so obsessed with money, which is here today and God and gone tomorrow. Tell them to go after God, who piles on all the riches we could ever manage, to do good, to be rich in helping others, to be extravagantly generous. If they do that, they'll build a treasury that will last, gaining life that is truly life. Now, this may not feel as though it applies to you as it is talking about the filthy rich, right? Well, if we look at ourselves in comparison to the rest of the world, we are, most of us are, filthy rich. The average worldwide household income for a year is $12,000, with the median being $2,920 for a household income. This means that if your family makes over $100,000 a year, you are in the top 10% of wealthiest people in the entire world. So even making an average of $50,000 to $75,000 per year, in the grand scheme of things, we are rich. And so this warning that Paul is giving to Timothy is a warning that we have to take on for ourselves. We cannot be obsessed over our money, but instead we are to do good, to be rich in helping others, and to be extravagant givers. And today we are really talking about what it means to be an extravagant giver, to give all that we can to bring about a new world and a new life that glorifies our risen Savior. Tithing is a step along this path, and it begins to get us in the mindset about being faithful givers, to where we are giving 10% of our income, but not extra money, but we are giving of the first bit of our income back to God, who all that we have is from anyway. We do this by giving in different ways. We do this by seeking to tithe to the church. This is the giving of the first 10% of our income to the mission and vision that God has here for our church community in Silver Lake. So that as we gather together and as we reach out to our community, that we can share the love of Christ, which we have generously received. Your tithes and your contributions to the church, they allow us to make a difference in our community. They show us our faithfulness to God. And if we want to see ourselves grow, both spiritually and as a congregation, this is one of the ways that we have to grow, is in our life as faithful givers to Jesus Christ. We give these tithes and our commitments to the church for the church's missions, for the ways that God is leading us, and the way that God allows us to be open and receptive to God's calls when they arrive. So that when God tells us to go and do something in our community, we don't have to sit in a board meeting and say, well, we don't have the money to fund that, so sorry, God, right now we're going to have to say no. And then it is to give above and beyond these tithes is then really what John Wesley is telling us is at the heart of what we're doing. It's not just about giving to the church budget, which is great, but it's about being able to support the other offerings that this church takes up and the other places that we do ministry. Whether that be offerings to help our youth cover the cost of their upcoming mission trip next year, or to buy presents for families who can't afford them at Christmas time. Or to support our mission partners like the Food Bank, the Good Neighbor Mission, or Topeka North Outreach. Or to give and support crisis when it strikes, such as natural disasters, helping those in our community when times are tough, and providing aid for those in the middle of war zones. Your excess of giving could even extend beyond what we do here in this community or what we take up collections for. It may be donating to cancer research or a hospital, or donating to a low-income school system, or providing funding to nonprofits seeking to end homelessness, or provide mental health resources to those who can't afford it, or to help out our veterans as they return to civilian life, or any of the countless number of charities that are close to each and every one of your hearts. When we give out of our relationship with Jesus Christ, we experience a new type of life. We no longer live in a life of scarcity where we're trying to figure out where that next dollar is going to come from, but we live in a life of abundance. Recognizing that these finances that we have are part of God's mission in the world and that we need to take care of ourselves, but we also need to take care of our neighbors. And we need to find ways to use our finances in appropriately so that we have what we need for the future. And so as we do this, we are living into what Paul is telling us about, to live into this new life where we become rich in love and we build up our treasures not here on earth, not in our bank accounts or in our investments, but we build up treasures in heaven where these building of resources will last forever. Next week, we will have the opportunity to come and place an estimate of giving card up here on the altar as a physical act of the spiritual nature of our gift, of saying, God, to you, I take this pledge, this estimate of my giving for the coming year. I have prayed over it. I have spent time and time having conversation with my family, with you, Lord, about what is my next step in my faith journey. And we're going to come and we're going to place those up on the altar next week as a way of saying, God, to you, this gift I give. And so throughout this last week of our stewardship time, I invite you to take this and every day say a prayer over how God is calling you to give and to move closer to that first step of tithing so that we can continue to be even more generous in our life. How can we fulfill this mission that God has given us as God's people to give to God all that we have been given to not become rich in wealth, but to become rich in love? And so this year, what I'm asking you to truly consider is making the step in giving 1% more of your income to move us closer to tithing, or if you're at tithing, to begin to push yourself to a new level, to begin to push yourself to giving even more. You should have received a letter a couple weeks ago that had some information that included a chart. This chart can be used to help you find out where your monthly giving currently is, to what that will look like in your future, is what that would be for another 1% of your income, so that we can continue to work forward to being faithful stewards of our resources, to give them back to God so that God can be faithful stewards of the resources we have and use those for God's mission here in the world. And so I truly hope that this next week, that this will be a time for you to be in constant prayer with God about what these next steps are, so that when we come here next week, we all can come forward as a way of placing forward on the altar our relationship with God, a way of saying, Lord, I give to you all that I have, and here is my commitment this year. I know that I seek to tithe, but that may not be where I am right now. I haven't quite figured out how to live that lifestyle, but here is my way of giving sacrificially to you, Lord. Of giving enough to where I know that I can make it, but to where I have to question some things about where are my priorities in life. This is our place as we come to the end of our stewardship series to really think about how we are to be stewards of our money, of our faith, to give back to God. And so I hope that as you go this week, you are praying for God to work in your hearts, to provide your souls, to make us not rich with money, but to make us rich in love. Amen. We come now to a time of hearing of some members of this congregation who are going to share with us their story of why they choose to support Silver Lake United Methodist Church. One of the wonders that has come out of our streaming that you'll get to hear about is we have people who worship with us, not just from Silver Lake or from Topeka, but that worship with us from around the country, including Virginia, where we have some very faithful members. And so I have invited Mike and Julie Snyder to share with us a video this morning to give us their reason on why they choose to be a part of our congregation, even though they live hundreds of miles away in Virginia. So I want to invite us to take a moment to just listen to this wonderful testimony of Mike and Julie.
Good morning from Virginia. Julie and I just want to thank Pastor Cameron and the rest of the church community for being so welcoming to us when we can be there in person. The COVID pandemic was dreadful, and if I could, I would wish it hadn't happened. But one blessing we got from the shutdown was Silver Lake United Methodist Church began to do online services. We've gone to churches here in Virginia in the past, but they were so big or so small, we could never really find a good fit for us. But I have always enjoyed attending services at the church, our church, when I could and when I was in the area. So the ability to be present, at least virtually, every Sunday is something we look forward to and are grateful for.
I fell in love with the church on my very first trip to meet Mike's parents. We attended church, and for the first time, I felt included and cared for. If my gifts can help someone else be exposed to the congregation and its pastors, it means the world to me. I want to make sure the church continues to have the resources to support all the programs and activities it provides. Giving money to the church through the last 23 years has filled me with joy. In the past, sometimes I have lost faith. I can honestly say being a part of this church has brought me closer to God and filled an emptiness I had before.
We support the church with gifts for several reasons. First of all, members of the church have helped and supported my family, just as my family has supported members of the church when they are in need. It truly is a church family. We also enjoy giving because of all the activities the church does and all the good it does for others, whether it's feeding people in the community, giving students experiences, or operating Vacation Bible School. We can't be there in person for that, so we feel we are contributing to all the good the church does and how it sends forth a message of how to live a life God would want.
I see on the news every day all the people suffering through poverty, wars, religious persecution. I am blessed to live a life without hate. I hope my contributions make God's work a little easier. Oh, and happy birthday to Lou Snyder.
Happy birthday, Dad.
Thank you, Mike and Julie, for sharing that wonderful testimony. And again, happy birthday, Lou. So we have now a time to collect of the offerings and the tithes that we bring to God this morning as a way to see the places where we are making a difference, to be involved in the ministry that these gifts do help support. And so I invite you to just consider the ways that your gifts are making an impact in the life and faith of the members of this congregation and the members of this community. So I want to invite our ushers to come forward and receive our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Holy and gracious God, we lift up to you today these gifts for your blessing, for them to be taken and expanded upon so that we may bring about your love here in this world through these generous gifts. Move in our hearts to make us to be the generous givers you call us to be, to give out of our state of abundance rather than a state of scarcity. Help us to live these gifts out in our lives as you have called us to be. It is in your holy and gracious name that we pray. Amen. I invite you now to remain standing as you are able and join in our closing hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be, number 399 in the hymnal. I want to just invite you again next week to come and join us in worship as we get to hear from the Reverend Dr. Dustin Petz, who is someone who has great knowledge and has a true passion for sharing about how our gifts can make a true difference in our lives now, and especially when this life is over, to continue to make a difference here forever and ever. And so I invite you to join us next week in service to hear his message, but then also to join us after worship next week from 11:30 to 12:30. In the fellowship hall for a wonderful presentation that he will give us. So as we go forward today, allow us to ingrain into us what it means to give all we can, to be generous givers who give of our resources, of our time, our talents, for your will, God, so that as we go forth in this world, we can build up a treasure that is made in heaven, a treasure of love that brings us into new relationship and into a new world here and now. And so as we go forth today, allow us to go forth spreading this love and this generosity that God has given us. The service is ended. You may go in peace. Thanks be to God. Amen.